then we have our next chapter leader. She is the immediate past president of WTS Boston, and she is also a founding member of our WTS Chapter Circle of Excellence programs, Allison Lima. Yes, that's applaud for all of them. That's great. This is a really great panel. Our next chapter leader is Virginia Epperly. Virginia Epperly is the immediate past president of Central Virginia. And she's one of our most active chapter leaders, coming up with tips constantly for us, great ideas. So she may have some good input on the panel. And then finally, we have Melissa Thompson. Melissa Thompson is local to Chicago, but now she's currently with WTS Kansas, Greater Kansas City. So she is a past president of Chicago, immediate past president, while she is the current president of WTS Kansas City. So, and our moderator, of course, is Marcia Ferranto, president and CEO of WTS International. And Marcia, I'll let you take it away.
Thank you, Tiffany. So let me give you a little bit of background of what we're doing and why we're doing this. Through our research with WTS, we have recognized that our membership success can be directly linked to our leadership at the chapter level. So as we continue to do membership drives and new membership rates, all of which are somewhat effective, there's nothing more effective than having the right leader leading a chapter. And so the board of directors of WTS International has decided in 2015 that we are going to work very hard in building the brand of WTS International Chapter Presidents. That this needs to be a position that people strive for. It needs to be a position that is recognized in the industry that you have served as a WTS International Chapter President. And that at WTS International, we have to make sure that your experience as a chapter leader is one that has a direct impact on your career and has a direct impact on your personal goals towards leadership. So with that being said, we talked about how chapter leaders today, in reality, fit, sort of find themselves in the role of chapter leadership. And sometimes it's because no one else wanted to do it, right? Okay, that model doesn't work. So sometimes it's because, they might have been guilted into it, right? Sometimes it's because the person they report to says, I want you to be the chapter president for, WTS, your local chapter. What we are hoping to do at WTS is to start to have our members think about and plan their leadership choices. And what does that mean for you as what we will call you aspiring chapter leaders? Some of you might sit through this panel discussion today and at the end say, guess what? My talents lie elsewhere. That is not what I want to do. Others of you might think, this is exactly what I want to do, and we are hoping that you start planning now. 3-5 years out, if you choose to be a chapter president. And that we, as WTS International, help you make that decision. And then when you ultimately become that chapter president, that we help raise you to a level of recognition within your local chapter, that it does have that impact professionally and personally. So this panel is by no mistake. They didn't volunteer. We didn't pull their names out of a hat. We actually sat down very strategically Tiffany and I, and we talked about who could we put on this panel and why would we choose the people to put on the panel and why you need to hear from them. And so let me tell you why. Dana Hook, has been the former president of the Seattle Puget Sound chapter, former chairwoman of the WTS International Board. And Dana brings to this panel years of experience with WTS, but probably more importantly, Dana really gets it. She gets what leaders need. She gets what it means to be a woman who has advanced through transportation, and she gets how important it is for leadership qualities to be fostered and how you can make them grow through your participation with WTS. Dana brings a wealth of information to this panel. Then we have Allison. Allison leads one of the, led, December, I was there when she stepped down. She skipped off the podium, so Allison is a former president for Boston. And Boston really does things right. We have a lot of chapters that do things right. And I'm not saying that Boston does it the best, but they are one of the best when it comes to making it work. It being a strong chapter with strong committees, and under Allison's leadership, it not only maintained, but it grew. And we can look at the numbers and so we can see under Allison's leadership how WTS Boston prospered. And it's really important for you to hear from her and her answers to some of the panel questions. And then we have Virginia Epperle. Virginia Lee was a former president of Richmond. What is it called?
Virginia.
Central Virginia. Virginia was one of those people who fell into it. They were like conspiring behind closed doors to get her to accept this position, and she didn't know it. And then she woke up one morning, and here she was. And she was the president of the chapter. But what she ended up doing, it has been phenomenal for our Virginia chapter. And so she came from maybe the area of non-preparation to success. And it's one of the things we're going to try to avoid in the future, that you know somebody gives Virginia the time to actually plan her leadership role. But we want to hear from Virginia on how she managed during that time. And then we have Melissa Thompson. What Melissa does is she just gets transferred by her company and she just starts a new chapter. So if any of you want her to work for you, just call her. And if you don't have a chapter in your local area, she'll start one. So anyway, Melissa led Chicago. And then she left Chicago and went to Kansas City. And she, are you currently still the president of Kansas City?
Yes.
Okay, so it's not only is she a former chapter president, but she's a current chapter president. And she started the Kansas City chapter. So you can imagine the wealth of knowledge that Melissa has at her fingertips. So let's get started. Let's talk to these wonderful panelists and let's learn and hear from them. And as you do, think about, is this meant for me? Or maybe do I know somebody that it's meant for? Okay, so I want to ask the panelists, that was there a moment or an occurrence that you experienced that made you realize that you wanted, that you had the passion to lead a WTS chapter? And Dana, can we start with you?
Sure. Hi, everybody. So for me, and some of you may have heard this before, I'm a leader because if there are leaders and followers, I'm a really lousy follower. And so I'm very comfortable setting direction and being in front of people and moving things forward. And so when I joined Puget Sound chapter, I mean, I was a membership chair, I think was my first position at the Puget Sound chapter. And that was great. But it wasn't very long before they asked me to join the executive board and then become the president. It's the best place if you know that you're a leader. And those of you who are going, you're right, I can't stand working under my boss because he's not very competent or she's not very competent, I'm very uncomfortable in that position. If that's you, you know that being the president is where you want to be. And your job then is to learn how to really attract followers. Because if you're leading and no one's following, Raina would say, you're just walking in the park. So for me, it was that it was a great chapter, connected with the best people in transportation. It was very active. There was wonderful people that were doing all the work that needs to be done. And I could help them move to the next level by bringing my leadership skills of setting some vision. We were getting ready to move into hosting a conference at the time. So setting those kinds of visions, figuring out how funding could happen, that I knew that it was a great place for me to be. So those of you who know that you're a leader, make sure you step into being the president. And if you're not sure that you're a leader yet, in the way that I see leadership, there are lots of other different kinds of leaders, and I'll let some of these people talk to how they see how they got to where they wanted to be a president.
Sure, thanks. So to give you, I guess, all a sense of Boston, for those of you who aren't familiar, Boston is a large chapter. We have 300 plus members, and this year we're actually celebrating our 35th anniversary. So definitely come in November because we're going to be partying. So with Boston, a lot of the things that other people from smaller chapters could speak to, like Toronto spoke to, this sort of initial growth, that's already been done. And in Boston, the idea is how do you take something that's really great and keep it going? And I would say for me, well, the Boston leadership is about 50 people. There's about a dozen people on the board. We have a lot of committee chairs, and we have an advisory board. So when you take all that into account, you have about 50 people. And of course, under each committee, there's more people. So there's actually a lot of people in the pipeline. In Boston, what really motivated me, now, I never really set out to be a chapter president. It's nothing that I really thought I was going to do. I really enjoyed my event planning role when I first got involved. But Boston has this model where we like our presidents to alternate public sector, private sector, public sector, private sector. And we do that 100% intentionally because we found that building that model, everything else falls into place because there's strong leadership from both sides, as opposed to maybe just having, say, a private sector organization, and then there's not a lot of growth there. So as I got more involved in the chapter, what I was starting to look at was our succession planning. And what we found is that the people active at the committee level were mostly almost all from the private sector. You'd have some people from the public sector, but it was harder for them to make the argument to their supervisors and stuff. So the reality is that the people that were really active at the committee level were largely private. And therefore, the people that were best prepared to be co-chairs of the committees were largely private. And then the people that were best prepared to be on the board were largely private. And then when you start thinking, oh, well, who's in the pipeline? It's like, oh, we have a huge gap. And in Massachusetts at the time, we had had a past president. Some of you know her, Louisa Pywanski. She used to run highway for the state. And because of her leadership and her position at the time, there was actually a decent pipeline of highway people. But then you start looking like, who's involved in transit? Who's involved in port? And so I think more from an organizational standpoint, I saw this huge void and a real problem that for the future of the chapter really had to be addressed, and really building this public sector participation and building the future public sector leaders, and getting people involved at a committee level so they're actually prepared to be a co-chair or a board. That was really what drove me personally from making the step to being just a really active member to deciding, I want to be the president.
So I want to add something to that. Over the 35 years that Boston has been in existence, if we were to graph their membership, it doesn't just go from 20 to 300. The graph actually goes like this. So if any of you are finding that inside your chapters that there has been, you've lost some ground, it doesn't just happen that you go straight up. And we can actually link the dips and the rises to strong leadership. So you truly have the opportunity as a chapter president to really affect that change within the chapter. So just recognize that all of you, as you're building chapters or thinking about building chapters, it doesn't just go straight up. Virginia.
So as Marcia said, I was kind of conspired against, or conspired for, it's better. It wasn't against. I was a founding member of the chapter in 2006, and I stepped in as a secretary because nobody really wanted to do it. And I had been secretary of other nonprofit boards, and I knew I could do it. And moving forward, I had to, for health reasons, I took a step back in 2007 and took some time off work. And with that came a little bit of a loss of confidence. The best thing that ever happened was the president then came back to me and said, come back, and got me involved in communications, and then said, okay, the vice president's stepping down, can you come back and step in for her? And I was like, I don't know if I can do it, okay. But I'd never, it was just, I'm doing people favors. It's not, I didn't see myself as a leader. But other people did. So all the while I'm learning these new skills that I had that I didn't realize that I had. So again, being conspired for, about 9 months before our election, these little hints start getting dropped to get me thinking about being president. All the while, I almost think I'm being used and abused because they keep getting to get me to do things that I think, like, that's the president should be doing that. It was succession planning. They just knew my personality enough to know that I would go running if I realized that they were trying to get me to be president. So eventually it dawned on me about June that I wanted to be president, that we sat down and had lunch and we talked about what I was already doing and why I could do it and why I would do it well. And I realized, yes, I did want to do it. And it's the best thing I've ever done. Not necessarily the easiest, but definitely the most worthwhile.
I can, I guess, pinpoint one year in particular that made me realize, okay, I want to be more involved in this organization. So I have been a board member as long as I've been a WTS member. So since 2003, so 12 years serving on boards. And I started as a communications chair. In 2005, I went to the Phoenix conference, and it was amazing. Not only because it was Phoenix, and I was from Chicago, and the weather was awesome, but it was just so inspiring. The women that I met and the people that I heard speak. And then I came back here, and in this very hotel, the Chicago chapter had their annual awards banquet, and our speaker that year was then Junior Senator Barack Obama. And we had 450 people in this room to hear him speak and to give awards to some incredible women and businesses. And I was like, this is an organization I want to be a part of. So Maggie Walsh became president, and she sat us all down and, you know, talked to us individually about what we want to do. I said, well, I'd like to be secretary, and I think I eventually want to be president. She's like, all right, let's make that happen. So secretary, vice president, president. So I definitely had the succession plan, and it was already planned out. In 2013, I decided I wanted to move home to Kansas City, and there was no chapter there. So I thought, I'm gonna start one. And Tiffany actually helped me out, and we sent an email out, out to all the membership, and Jean Olabogan, I never say her last name right, in St. Louis, contacted me, and she got me in touch with some women. We met for the first time in July, and we were a chapter by December. So, like Dana said, I've always been a leader, not a follower, and if something's not there, build it. Start it.
Okay, and we're going to stick with you, Melissa. Can you tell the group how being a chapter president has impacted your career?
Just WTS as an organization has impacted my career. I have found two of the jobs that I've had through people I've met through this organization. But I think more than anything, it's given me a huge network. And that was one of my fears when I left Chicago, is I was leaving this huge network that I had developed over time, a voice, when the Secretary of Transportation sends you a handwritten thank you note saying, thank you for having me speak at your event, that's pretty cool. Looking at all of the blue ribbon panelists, and I can say I've met over half of them, it's pretty cool. So just that confidence, that network, knowing that you can touch these people that seem untouchable, and they're really not. And then moving to Kansas City, and it's helped me gain visibility as a person, as a professional, for my organization, and just it's helped me so much advance in my career, especially being relatively young still, I hope. We are. So it's been a huge impact.
Good. Virginia, how about you?
You may look at my job title and say it hasn't impacted my career, but I would say that because it's impacted my confidence, it has. Through my network, it definitely has. And, just because it's impacted my confidence, I am considering applying for jobs that I never would have considered applying for. While I was still president, took my presidency on, I was working in private sector. I now work in the public sector. So that's probably a change that I may not have considered had I not been involved in WTS, just because I started thinking more strategically. And I started seeing things differently and seeing benefits to things a little bit different in different ways. When people who are planning ASHTO conferences call you and say, we need speaker recommendations for two different events, and we'd love it if somebody with a WTS tie-in, and you reach out to the network, some of you may be in the room, and you get pouring back in, it's pretty powerful, and they love WTS. They love you, they love WTS, so it's going to have an impact. So I feel fairly confident about it.
Allison?
I would say, well, it's definitely haven't had an impact, and I think for anybody who's a young person at work, if you think about what your personal career trajectory is, it's probably very linear for me, I'm a structural engineer. So, then I want to manage projects. Then I want to manage bigger projects. Then, there's a path. It's very linear, and people think of you as a structural engineer. And I think for me, definitely I want to second everything that everybody said about the networking. People within my own company, people within the industry have just had so many opportunities to see me as more than just a structural engineer. And they see leadership abilities, they see effective public speaking abilities, they see genuine excitement and care to help people grow. And I think when people are able to see you in that WTS stage, all of a sudden you have all these transferable skills, whether it's within your company or outside in the industry. The other thing I'd say at WTS Boston, and I'm sure it's true at all the chapters, we use this analogy of a ladder. And as you're climbing up the ladder, all those people that came before you need to reach down and pull you up. But it's also your opportunity to look and help all the people coming up behind you and pull them up. And that definitely is an analogy that is valid in Boston, no matter where you're involved. But when you're the president, the women that are above you on the ladder, who really genuinely will do anything to help you succeed, those women, as Virginia said, they're at your fingertips, and they're just so genuinely want you to succeed. And, oh, call me if you need help. Call me if you need help. And then I start calling, and you know what? They help every single time. And so having that support network which is much more than just a bunch of people that you know or a bunch of people that you met. I mean, these are people that really would do anything to create opportunities for you.
Amen. The WTS network is something that I've used throughout my career to find partners for jobs. Across the country, I've reached out for peer reviews for clients that I've reached out to the WTS network when I was in Seattle, and I called Dallas, and I called Los Angeles. Hey, I need somebody to, they respond. And that makes you successful, which is the most important part of what you do, right? You do good work, that's the basis. But also, I actually have a very compelling story, is that when I was interviewed to be the chair of WTS, which is an interview process, and people from around the country that Marcia puts together call you and interview you about the international board. And one of those persons was Kelly Burnroy, who is the president of CDM Smith. And this was several years ago. And we went through this interview, and she asked me some question, and I did whatever it is I do, and I say, oh, well, you know, and we could do this, and communities, and people, and importance, and industry. And I finished, and she says, I'm going to hire you. It took her 2 years to convince me to do that, but she recruited me monthly for 2 years to come over and join her in establishing transportation at CDM Smith. So to think that it impacts your career, you may not know when, and you may not know where, but you should know why. WTS makes a difference.
So when you were considering becoming a chapter president, what were some of the things that you had to take in consideration before you said, I do? You know, because I don't think that anyone in this room who would consider being a chapter president could just, you know, tomorrow say, this is what I'm going to do. What are the things you had to take into consideration? What are the obstacles you had to get over to say, I'm going to commit 2 years of my time leading this organization?
I guess the first thing is that I think the barrier to entry is a I don't have time sort of thing. So I guess the first thing I just want to put out there is that I'm actually a very busy person, like everybody else. I'm married. I have 3 kids. When I was a co-chair, I had my first child, and then when I was on the board, I had my twin, so second and third child, and WTS just supported me through that whole thing. But the reality is that going into a presidency, I'm obviously married, I have 3 kids in elementary school, I want to see them. And so the first thing I needed to figure out is, how can this work for me? Because the model of how the person did it before you or did it before the person, et cetera, maybe that actually doesn't work for me. I'm a huge delegator, so anybody in Boston will tell you that that's true. And I also, there's no way you can do everything. So I think you need to figure out what's most important to you. And I think the other key thing is having people really energized to participate and make a difference. I spent a lot of time actually talking one-on-one to people, and I found out, like, this person is totally jazzed up about appointments. She wants to see more women in appointments in Massachusetts. Do I have the time to do that? No. But does she? Oh my God, she has so much passion. So she's the head of our appointments task force. And I attend meetings and I participate in all of these sorts of things. But that's but one thing. You can plant all these seeds, and you're the person that keeps everything going, but you're not necessarily the doer of everything, because it's not really sustainable. So I would say, as you're trying to figure out if this is going to be a good fit for you, and certainly something that was a good fit for me, is making sure you have these people that are totally psyched up, each with their own passions. And if you can take the time to talk to them and find out what their passions are, all of a sudden there's all these things that you can accomplish as president without actually doing anything, right? Because they're going to do it, and that'll just sort of function on its own. The other thing that we haven't really talked about is employer support. That's something that I actually never considered, but I know a lot of people do. When I was coming up through the co-chair, I co-chaired a committee with a woman who is now my boss. We weren't working together at the time, but so I know she gets WTS. She's seen a lot of growth in me individually, and of course she supported it, but honestly, it's such a great opportunity, and it's such an honor to be in this position that if my company didn't support it, I probably would have left and found somebody that would.
Wow. I'm gonna try not to sound like a parrot. So one of the biggest things I probably had to overcome in a lot of ways was myself. Delegation is a huge part, and sometimes when you work with people, you take on their traits, and if you work with people who tend not to delegate, sometimes you start to keep things to yourself too. So having had conversations with previous presidents, we identified that as one of my things that I was going to have to overcome as well, was learning to delegate. I have learned to delegate much more effectively. Still working on it, but it's much better. But also, I think one of the things that I've done a better job for the chapter for is identifying volunteers. When someone comes to a chapter event and they're new, find out why they came, what they're passionate about, and kind of pull them into the ranks. Myself probably is. But then other things I considered would be, I did talk to my employer and made sure I had their support. And then in changing jobs, make sure that I didn't have their objection, since it was a public sector position.
Okay, and Melissa, I'm gonna add something to yours, to your question. This is a surprise. So the things that you had to take into consideration when you were choosing to be a chapter leader, you went to Kansas City and you probably didn't know all the connections in transportation at the highest levels. So you went in without a lot of relationships. I'm making an assumption.
You are completely correct.
Okay, so you had, so there's things that you needed to consider. And then I also want you to talk to going into an area as a chapter president and not having the contacts of the transportation leaders in your area.
Well, to the first point, I think what Allison and Virginia have said, I'm going to echo. It's so important that you don't micromanage, that you do delegate, and that you have strong committee chairs. It was difficult going in and saying, oh my goodness, I have no idea how I'm gonna start a chapter when I don't know a single person in transportation. At the time, the company I worked for didn't even do transportation. So, and I didn't ask for their support, I just did it. It was something that I was going to do on my own, whether they supported it or not. So really, it was reaching out to Tiffany, and Tiffany connecting me with Jean, who connected me with Barb and Kimberly and Julie and all these people who had connections. And I was very fortunate that it fell into place, that main group that came together, we all said, all right, we're going to start this chapter. And then we just sort of naturally divided up into what role or what committee chair we wanted. And it's been great. There's been a few who have stepped down or stepped into different roles. And it's very important to me to make sure if I see that someone's struggling, let's go have coffee, let's go have lunch, let's see what we can do to make this a better situation for you, better situation for the organization. You know, we're struggling, for example, Transportation U is really difficult for us right now because we're a new chapter. So we're going to step back from that, focus on trying to take a year to decide what we want our program to look like, and then come back to it. So I think it's you know, identifying that. It's also been a struggle for me because I come from Chicago, and so I have these expectations of big chapter, big city, and Kansas City is so much different. So it's just kind of tempering those expectations and realizing that there isn't really a one-size-fits-all approach to WTS and to what we do. But like I said, I've been very fortunate to find good help, good committee chairs, and I think that our chapter is going to be really strong in the future with those women.
Okay, and back down here to Dana. Dana, I'm going to change the question up for you because it seems like there's a common thread here as far as what you need to consider when thinking about being a chapter president. So Dana, for the last question, I'm going to ask you. So your history with WTS goes to the chapter level, it goes to the board level. You've seen success within the organization. You have met many chapter presidents. Can you describe what a successful chapter president looks like?
And now I'm done. I think what I really appreciated from all of their comments that I can't tell you enough is about delegation. As a leader, I mentioned that you have to be recruiting followers, right? Those include your committee chairs. Those include people from the agencies, the transportation agencies you want to be in WTS. Those include everyone around you, and then you take care of them. That's where you see a chapter president that makes a difference in those numbers that Marcia will say. They're confident in themselves. They will go and they will talk to leaders because they know they are a leader. But they will take care of the people that are doing the work. Delegation and trusting and building them up is the full-time job of the WTS president. And when you are understanding that by sharing every relationship you have and you gain at WTS with other people, you are committed to the organization by providing a succession plan that is naturally occurring. Because when I leave, everybody on the board should know every person that I do. That's my job. And as a chapter president, if you think of yourself as, I'm responsible for the organization and its presence, and I'm good at it because I am the leader, I am the president. But the work you're doing is caring for the ones that will follow you and the ones that are doing the work of getting out newsletters and putting on events and having scholarships and all those details. You're caring for them so that they're growing. You will be a phenomenal chapter president. That's what I think.
Amazing women we have up here. All right, so let's open it up to questions, Q&A. Wow, I love this. All right, right here, Tracy, you want to start?
I don't know if I need a mic.
Okay, good morning. So 2 years ago, I guess there were maybe three, in San Antonio, I gave like a presentation. And in that presentation, I had a slide that stated that I had purposely avoided being an officer. I've been on a WTS board as well since 1999, every year, three different chapters. And so someone pulled me aside that day and said, we need to have a conversation. Why are you avoiding being a treasurer, secretary, president, or vice president? And quite honestly, I felt like, for me, as a part of supporting women, I want the people who I support and am closest to fulfill their dreams. And I found that I was holding myself back because Colleen wanted to be president, and so-and-so wanted to be president, and this person wanted to be president, and that person wanted to be president. And so how do you balance advancing but still supporting other folks at the same time? And I think that's what I struggle with the most. So I wound up being an overactive director, being on too many committees. I mean, we have directors that aren't on any, you know, or always working to help somebody else and still kind of putting the things, the goals and dreams I have on the back burner. I hope that is clear.
Can I take that?
Yes. You have mine.
So I'll just address that personally. In Boston, there's the progression is that you're a co-chair, and then after you're a co-chair, you're on the board, and we have director of large positions. And then we have the executive board members. So typically, if you want to be president, you're treasurer, you're secretary, and then you're VP. And when you're VP, you're going to be president. But until you're VP, there's no official track. And so some people go to be secretary, and then they go off the board and stuff like that. So that said, it's really VP that is the big contested race. And because
we have this public-private alternating schedule, but yet an overabundance of people from the private sector. We definitely have people that want the opportunities, and of course you know who they are, and of course they would be fabulous. And so the issue is, like you're saying, do you put yourself out there knowing that they'd do a great job too? And I'll say in Boston, when it was time for me to put my name in the hat for VP, there was a woman who was in line, I'd say, ahead of me, a more senior woman, and I thought that she would do a phenomenal job. And she actually had been in line for a while. And so I figured I wasn't going to put my name in the hat out of respect for her because of all the years she put in. But then I found out, because of all of her family commitments and other commitments at work, she decided she couldn't make the commitment to be president. And I knew there was going to be somebody else running who was more my peer. And I thought, I'll go for it. And I was a little bit nervous, and of course, I think the thing with WTS is that everybody is so positive, so sometimes it's hard to get good feedback. So of course, I reached out to my people in WTS that of course said, oh yeah, put your name in. But I also reached out to a male mentor who's no longer with my company, and I explained the whole situation to him, and he said, do it. You put your name in. If the other person beats you, doesn't matter, because next time you'll be in a better position. And I think that where you're thinking that you're taking opportunities away from people by potentially putting your name in the ring, it could be the other way, because you could really create so many opportunities for people when you are that leader.
I'm Tammy. I'm on the board for the Boston chapter. My question is, can you describe your challenges, frustrations, or obstacles that you faced during your presidency? What happened, or what do you think you could have done better?
Do you have someone in mind, or anyone?
No, I only know Allison.
Okay. So Central Virginia is a fairly small chapter, so the challenges in a fairly or mid to small chapter would probably be far different from Boston. It's managing chaos to some degrees, but I am so much better at managing chaos than I was. That's a skill that I know I'll take with me. It programs gone awry, that people come to you, the committees come to you for advice. Budget concerns. It's in a way, as president, you need to keep yourself elevated above the fray and let the committees deal with minutia. On a smaller chapter, unfortunately, sometimes committees get very, can't think of a good word, but there sometimes it is just a chair. And so sometimes there are ad hoc committees that are overlapping. And so sometimes you are getting pulled into the fray. And so you have to be ever mindful to keep yourself above that and maybe give advice, but try to stay out of it. And so that, to me, is a balancing act.
Melissa, how about you?
I would say our biggest challenge right now is being a small fish in a big pond, being kind of the new kid on the block in Kansas City and transportation. We are still perceived as a women's organization. So I look out at our programs and there's maybe one or two men in the room. And so trying to market ourselves as we are transportation, yes, our mission is advancing women in transportation, but we are not just all women, you know, and trying to get men in the room and men at the table. You know, we also, as I say, don't micromanage, but at the same time, make sure that you know what's going on with all of your committees. We've had we've had great programs, but we've had a couple programs that the focus just continues to be the, you know, breaking the glass ceiling and, you know, kind of the touchy-feely women stuff. And I'm like, all right, we've done this. Let's talk about the real issues. Let's talk about all the great transportation projects and all the great, you know, leaders that we have who are women in the Kansas City area, and not the kind of softer side of things all the time. And so it's just making sure that you know, we're not too far down the planning path and I find out we've got a program and this is the date it is and no one told you about it. And so making sure that when you do find that out too, that the way you react to it is very professional. And there have been times that I just shake my head. So you just make sure that you empower but also stay engaged.
So we kind of talked about this last question with the succession planning. I was wondering if you had advice or techniques on preparing to, to evaluate yourself for when you want to advance, to compare yourself to your peers, when you're overstepping boundaries for respect lines, that you're ready to become a president or ready for a promotion, how to do it in a professional manner to know that you're ready for that next step.
Hey, Dan, that's one that you should...
Personally, I don't understand the question at all. And some of you know that, you know, I really started my career 15 years ago and was out of the workforce for 15 years. So I was 39 when I went back to work as a traffic assistant. Let's see, traffic tech maybe, laying road hoses for Pima County DOT. With my Purdue engineering degree and my MBA. I don't do that anymore. And so what I would say is that we would not have this conversation if I was sitting here with more men in the room. Go for things. When you say, you know, I'm ready, I got time now, this thing that someone else may feel like, oh man, they're overstepping their bounds. You know, people will always say that. When you're ready and you know that you're ready, you know that you want it. Just like someone talked about, you know, finding a chair that has passion about something. When you know, I am ready to run this organization. I have done my, you know, just walk in the first day. I joined WTS and tomorrow I'm going to be president. Well, sometimes I say things like that, but I didn't when it came to WTS. But put yourself and just do it. This is a lot of thought that is going into how do you plan this and whatever. And I would tell you that it doesn't always act out like you planned. I did not plan any of my career. I certainly didn't plan on staying home. I didn't plan on not staying home, so evidently that happened. Be more yourself and know who that is and step into that. I can see some of you out there that are so ready. I can tell by the looks in your eyes that you want to do this. And yes, there are nice ways and there are good ways and you can see that other people do things in more polite ways than you. not Marcia, she doesn't do things that way. But when you know that you're ready and you have something to offer, offer it. And you'll be surprised that people will go, well, of course. And there will always be people that say, are you kidding me? She was very pushy in that. I mean, you're doing it very politely, but you can still be seen pushy just by saying, I want to run this. I want to do this. I'm ready for this. But you're not. You're just stating it. And that's what I would tell you is, when you know that you're ready and you understand a little bit. I mean, I think I'd been in Seattle 3 years when they asked me to be the president. So again, moving into a place that you don't know very well. I knew no one when I got there. I think my first day of work, I got dragged to a WTS meeting. And that's how I knew WTS. And a man dragged me and said, you're going to here. And I met Grace Cunningham at that first meeting. And but I do not hesitate. We need women to be leaders. We need women in transportation, and WTS provides an opportunity for you to show those leadership skills earlier than you probably will get to in your organizations. So take advantage of them. And, you know, and just because you ask and you say, okay, I'm ready, and someone else wins the election, so what? Run again. There's nothing wrong with that. People need to know that you're ready, and that you believe you're ready. And then the organization will benefit from that leadership itself. That's what I would tell you.
Donna, you talked about, Dana, apologies. You talked about making sure you recruit followers. And in recruiting members, one of the things that we want to do is make sure that people are properly placed or even placed at all. But how do you nudge people to actually join one of the committees? Because I'll get a lot of people that say, sure, I'll join, but I don't want to do anything. I mean, we can get the recruitment underway. We can get them in, but we can't get them to commit.
So I think a conference, maybe, well, anyway, a recent conference, somebody talked about ask early. And people will volunteer, but people are hesitant to volunteer. So and ask small. And if I can get them engaged early, then I can usually get them to stay engaged. And we've had a lot of success with that. But if I don't ask, I might not even get them back to another event.
Yeah, so I guess stand up. It's been sitting long enough. I will tell you that the advantage you get from WTS is not by belonging. It is by leading. It is by taking on a committee. It is by putting together programs. You know, it is by doing that. That's where you're growing. And if you have someone that of course we want members, right? That's part of the chapter growth. But when you see someone and they want to, and you're recruiting followers, you know, you have to be able to tell them, you know, this is your advantage. In my companies, I've always told employees, I don't want you to enjoy so that you go to a lunch once a month. I want you to join so you will be a chapter president. Because that's where your companies get value. But that's also where the individuals get value. And those are the people that are most valuable. So if you have a number of people and they just want to join, great, those are membership numbers. But when you're talking to someone about being a follower, you have to be presenting this is what makes a difference. This is where you get to practice who you are and what you want to be as a leader and as someone who is then seen in the industry as more than just a structural engineer, which just a structural engineer is in itself an accomplishment, just a member of the DOT, right? Just a newcomer to town. Okay, those are all very difficult things to do. But the reason you're sitting in this room is you want to know, what does it take to do the next thing? It takes stepping up and doing the next thing. And WTS needs you.
Allison, because Boston is so incredible in their committee structure, and let me give you an example of what I experienced in Boston. It was a real aha moment. So in
December, I went to their annual awards banquet, and a holiday party, whatever. And so there was probably, I'm going to make this up, 200 people in the room. And one of the things they did was they recognized their committees. And I was just like, oh, isn't that nice? We're going to recognize committees. And the committee list went on and on and on, and people were standing and sitting and standing and sitting all over the room. And I had this like aha moment that I think so much of chapter leader success is getting those committees in place, helps you delegate, but also each one of those committee members probably brought one person to that holiday party. And so with this very strong committee structure, I think it has a direct link to getting more members into your chapter. So because you have so many committees, can you address that question about, you know, getting strong committees? Isn't that what you asked?
How to get them active.
Right. So you have people stepping up, and then how do you keep volunteers accountable?
So I guess getting back to what I had said before, if you figure out what people are passionate about, use them as a volunteer in that capacity. Because if they're totally excited about appointments, for example, and you really have a hole on your newsletter committee, they're really not going to have their heart into it, and they're just going to do their term. I would say that, Marcia, as you were talking, I had this fabulous epiphany that I had forgotten. I think one, so I think you can't, you have to ask. You can't force people to do different things. They have to make that choice for themselves. I think energy and seeing other people excited breeds more energy and enthusiasm. So I think if you have people that are involved and they're somewhat of a wallflower, you could always encourage them to be more involved. But really the reason they're going to get more involved is because their committee co-chair says, you know, oh, Tiffany, I need you to help with blah, 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 because they know Tiffany is totally passionate about that. And then Tiffany will step up and she'll take ownership of that and she'll be so proud. I'll say the other thing that I did as president, everybody kind of has a different style for recognition. My style was to always try to recognize people, not just the actual individual, but also always find an opportunity to talk to their supervisor. There was somebody who came to the conference last year. She really wanted to go. I knew she wanted to go. She didn't know how to ask. And I'm like, what? You don't know how to ask to go? And so she reports to somebody who reports to somebody who reports da 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 to Margaret O'Mara. So I called Margaret and I said, just so you know, she really wants to go. Can you tell her how to ask? Well, of course, Margaret just approved her trip. And she just feels so this committee co-chair just felt so fortunate that I got her approved. Even though I didn't get her approved, I just asked. So I think really kind of making a meaningful give back to people. The other thing that I did, just in terms of recognition, because I think people really enjoy being recognized, and that when people, this is a volunteer thing, so when you're really making a big investment in something, you want to be recognized. So I would write thank you notes to everybody at the end of the year. But then I got feedback from some people, especially in the public sector, they weren't sure that their supervisor knew what they did. And I said, oh, that's fascinating. And that never occurred to me. So I got the name of everybody's supervisor and I wrote a letter to the person saying, you know, gee, Tiffany, I so much appreciate the way you've just enhanced our membership program this year. It's gone crazy. And then I'd write an email to Tiffany's boss. And I'd say, Marcia, I don't know if you know this, but Tiffany's efforts on membership have just really blah, 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 blah. And then I took it a step higher. So say an agency head, somebody leading highway, I sent them a list of all the people in their organization that are so far removed from them who were making an effort. And from those letters, I did it for a couple years because I was president for 2 years, I actually got tons of feedback. A lot of people were so thankful. And I think that when you're really authentic and you just really appreciate what everybody's doing, because it's all volunteer, they have a reaction to give back more.
Okay, thank you. We have to wind it up. Tammy, do you have one quick
I have been in my, I'm 23 years, I'm a retiree this year. I've been in my organization in senior position for many years, and I have a mentor and was a past president. What I'd like to say is that she's absolutely correct. I thought I was too busy. And when the president makes a call, when I ask if you were on the board, it's different. I have friends that wanted to join, but when the president calls them after hours at like 6:30 and says, look, I think you'd be great on mentoring. Past President Lisa Fletchman called me, and I'm like, wow, she called me to ask me. Same thing with on the board. Allison called me, hey, I know you're busy. It makes a huge difference when a president picks up that phone and says, hey, so-and-so thinks you'll be great. That's how I got involved at the committee and then wanted to.
Thank you. Thank you. So I hope you all found this information useful. I hope that it helps you. I know that each one of these panelists would be glad to talk to you individually. You can find them here at the conference. We can get you their email addresses. Feel free to reach out and tap them for their knowledge. But we encourage you to continue to think about your chapter presidency, if this is for you, and encourage others also. So thank you for being here, and thank you to the panel.